Hello everyone, I'm Nitzahone and it's Friday, so that means it's time for one of my top 10s. Normally, my top 10s look back at the history of Magic and, you know, I do some research and come up with the cards that have done the best in competitive Magic's history. But this week, if you haven't noticed, my channel has been taken over by Rivals of Ixalan Limited Review Week, and that includes my MTG top 10. Next week, we'll be back with your more normal MTG top 10 about, you know, actually, I'll just tell you what it is. We're doing top 10 Eldrazi next week, so you have that to look forward to. But this week, we're looking at Rivals of Ixalan Limited Bombs. These are the 10 cards in Rivals of Ixalan you most want to have in your sealed pool, or you most want to start your draft with. There are a lot of powerful cards in Rivals of Ixalan, but these are the 10 that I think are the most powerful at this point. Of course, things could end up moving around. No one's actually had the chance to play the format yet, but this is how I see things now. At number 10, I have Tender Shoot Dryad. So this thing's really good. It has a small body, and that's not normally what you think of when you think of bomb, right? It makes a sapling during every upkeep, not just during your own, a callback to Verdant Force. And once you ascend, which, by the way, it helps you do by making sapling tokens very quickly, it becomes a sapling lord and makes them all into much scarier creatures. It has the downside of being easily killable, but if your opponent doesn't kill this, they're going to die because of your army of saplings. At number 9, we have Warkite Marauder. That's right, back-to-back, not actually huge bombs. They're not big creatures, they're just powerful ones. Warkite Marauder is a 2-mana 2-1 with flying, which, hey, that's good limited stats, but not usually bomb-worthy. What I think makes this so good is the fact that when it attacks, it makes one of your opponent's creatures into nothing, basically. A 0-1 blocker, which means it's going to open the floodgates. It's going to let you attack with a bunch of other creatures if you're making their best blocker into a complete dud. And that's what I like about it. It can also be killed easily, but it's going to lead your army to victory in a lot of cases if your opponent doesn't kill it. So from here on out, the creatures are a lot bigger, I promise, but these two were sort of strange in that I think they're very powerful cards, but they are quite small. At number 8, we have Champion of Dusk, which is, you know, a 4/4 vampire. But what really matters about it is the fact that when it comes into play, you get to draw a ton of cards. Yeah, you have to pay some life too, but who cares when you're drawing that many cards? It's even good on its own. If it's the only vampire in your whole deck, it's a 5-mana 4/4 that draws you a card, which, hey, that's a high-quality card, not quite a bomb. But where it's a bomb is in a vampire deck where you can consistently draw 4 or 5 cards and mitigate against the life gain by gaining some life. Champion of Dusk is great. It's just going to win you games because of the sheer card advantage. At number 7, I have the first of 3 Elder Dinosaurs to make this list. That's right, there are 2 that are not on this list. You will see later which ones those are not. But the first of them I have is Galta Primal Hunger. He does require some setup, but not a lot. I mean, he asks you to have creatures in play. Hey, that's going to happen. Okay, it's a little more than that. He wants you to have creatures with decent power in play. But honestly, it's not that far-fetched to say have 6 power worth of creatures in play on turn 6, right? Like, that's 3/2/2s, a couple 3/3s, right? That's not crazy. And that means you get to play him on turn 6 as a 12/12 trampler, okay? There are going to be crazier situations involving ramp and involving playing, you know, other bigger creatures more quickly where you can play Galta even faster. Playing him as a 6-mana 6/6 is not a rare thing that's going to happen. It will happen, and it's going to suck for you unless you're the one casting him. He does have the downside of being pretty terrible on, like, an empty board because you're just never going to be able to cast him. But how often is your board going to be empty? I mean, come on. This is Ixalan. It's a tribal format. There's creatures running all over the place. So Galta's great and, you know, one of the cards that you really want to have in your sealed pool or as your first pick. At number 6, we have the only gold card on this list. That's right. There are no planeswalkers on this list. The 2 planeswalkers in this set are powerful, but I think all the cards on this list are better, and Azor is one of them. A 6-mana 6/6 with flying that makes it so your opponent can't cast instant or sorcery spells during their next turn already means it's harder to kill than your normal creature once it comes into play. Your opponent can just wait to cast an instant until your upkeep, but hey, at least you're making them, you know, use their mana on your turn, I guess. But what really makes Azor a bomb, in addition to the huge body, is the fact that every time he attacks, you have the option to cast Sphinx's Revelation, except it can't be countered because it isn't a spell, and that's insane. Even if you just, like, play him, and then you only have 6 lands in play, you only get to attack with him once, and then they kill him, you get to draw 3 cards and gain 3 life by paying 6 mana, and that's going to be enough to put you ahead in most situations. If he attacks more than once, your opponent is basically never going to win the game between the card advantage and the 12 damage you've done to their face. The only reason he's not higher, because in sheer power, he surely could be, and maybe even would be, number 1. is because he's gold, and not only is he gold, he's incredibly difficult to splash because he costs double white and double blue. So that's the only thing that holds him back from being higher up on this list. He still makes it all the way up to number 6, despite the prohibitive mana cost. At number 5, we have a card that does not have a hard-to-cost mana. It's just colorless, and that is the Immortal Sun. It is awesome. It does a lot of things. It starts drawing you an extra card every turn. It makes all your spells cost 1 less to cast, which, by the way, sometimes people think spells means instants and sorceries only. No, spells means everything. Enchantments, creatures, everything. All your everything costs 1 less to cast. And, oh, it also adds an anthem effect. So when you play it, it has an immediate effect on your board by making your creatures bigger. It also shuts down planeswalkers, which will occasionally come up. But the other stuff is what matters. It'll make your board immediately bigger. You'll be drawing an extra card next turn. And, oh, by the way, the cards you draw are cheaper to cast. So playing more than one a turn isn't going to be very hard. So the Immortal Sun is great. The downside it has is if this format turns out to be incredibly fast, paying 6 mana for this and not adding to your board could be incredibly frightening. But if you're making your creatures big enough to at least sort of rumble to battle with your opponent's creatures, by playing it, it's still worth it. And once you get to untap with this, your opponent's going to start falling very far behind. At number 4, I have Trapjaw Tyrant, a 5-mana 5/5 who has a very powerful Enrage trigger. He exiles things if he gets mad. When he gets damaged, he exiles things. Sure, they get their guys back when he dies, which is true of most white effects like this. But what's really crazy about this card is how impossible it is to chump block it or anything. Because if you just, you're just going to have to take 5 from it because you're... If you don't have a creature who's big enough to kill it in combat, guess what? You can't block it because it's going to exile something else. Sure, you can double block it, but if you're, you know, you're getting a 2-for-1 then, and that's pretty solid. But in most scenarios, like your opponent's board's just not going to be able to come together for an effective block. Alternatively, if you're far behind and you can't attack, and suddenly you play this thing, your opponent can't attack into it very effectively either, unless all of their creatures are 5/5 or bigger. So you're... It's a bomb, as all the cards on this list really are, in part because it can get you back into control of the game even from behind, and it really can do that. And Trapjaw Tyrant is great. At number 3, we have Rekindling Phoenix, a 4-mana 4/3 flyer, which is already really great stats, but certainly not a bomb. But what makes it a bomb is that when it dies, it makes a 0/1 red elemental creature token that on your next upkeep sacrifices itself and brings back Rekindling Phoenix. Well, if that's all it did, that would be really good, right? But it also gives it haste, because why not? Let's also give it haste when it comes back. That's crazy, and it's an amazing card, very powerful. Downside? Well, the biggest downside, the biggest fail case here, right, is your opponent kills that elemental token, okay? If that's what they're doing, they just 2-for-1 themselves, and that's your fail case, you're still in pretty good shape. The one place where it could get kind of ugly is that there are a few ways in the format to do one to the whole board, and then your opponent really isn't using a whole card, in which case you're not going to feel so good. But most of the time, this is going to be a Phoenix coming back from the graveyard every single turn, or maybe not always coming back, but it's going to be very difficult to deal with and hit your opponent very hard in the air. At number 2, we have our next Elder Dinosaur, which is a Tali Primal Storm. I had a hard time deciding which of the two Elder Dinosaurs who are still on this list would be number 1, and in the end, I made my decision, and I'll explain why. But a Tali Primal Storm is insane. It's a 6-mana 6/6, great stats, right? But when it attacks, it exiles cards off of every library, which, unless you're playing Two-Headed Giant, just means 2 libraries. And not only do you get to play those cards, which would already be pretty good, I'd be pretty happy with that, you can play them without paying anything for them. Okay, so yeah, it can hit lands, and you don't get to do anything with those. But if you hit anything else, you get to cast it for free. Whether it's a creature, an instant, a sorcery, an enchantment, whatever it is, it's probably going to be useful, and it's going to be free. And if it just swings once, that could potentially be at least a 3-for-1. If it swings twice, your opponent probably loses. And that is what makes it incredibly powerful. I decided in the end it's not quite as good as our number 1 on the list, because our number 1 on the list has an immediate impact on the board. A Tali Primal Storm, if it just gets killed after you play it, you don't have anything to show for it. Tetsamok Primal Death, which is number 1, does. So a 6-mana 6/6 Death Toucher is great, but before it comes into play, you can reveal it from your hand and pay 1 black mana to put prey counters on things. And when you play it, it just destroys all those things that it put prey counters on. So what's the downside here? Your opponent knows Tetsamok is coming at some point. I guess that's a little bit of a downside. But that's not much of one. Even if all you're doing is paying one black and killing one thing when this comes into play, that's a really good deal. A 6-mana 6/6 with Death Touch that kills something when it comes into play. It's going to be better than that most of the time, though. If you have this in your hand in the early game and you, like, you know, on turn 3, the best thing you can do is, like, play a 2-drop. You can just put a Prey counter on something, right? And then in the later game, it'll get killed by Tetsamok. Alternatively, if you draw it late and you have like 9 mana laying around, you can pay 3 black, put 3 prey counters on something, and drop Tetsamok, and that is savage. That will get you back in front of any game, basically. Tetsamok Primal Death, I think, is the biggest bomb in the format. The other two Elder Dragons didn't even make the list. Elder Dinosaurs, rather. I don't think they're bombs, actually. They're both big, scary creatures, but they don't give you enough of a payoff for playing them, and they both cost kind of a lot of mana for what they are. So, you know, sorry if you're a fan of those other two. They're certainly good, and they're not, I'm not saying they're bad, but they're not top 10 bomb material. So that's my list. Those are my picks for the 10 biggest, basically, rares and mythics that you want to get in your sealed pools, that you want to open in your packs when you're drafting, because they're just so game-shattering and powerful. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit the like button and share it so others can enjoy it too. If you want to make sure you catch more of my videos, including more Ixalan content, Rivals of Ixalan content, including draft videos starting next week once it's on Magic Online, don't forget to subscribe. Also, if you want to give back to the channel, if you feel like I've helped you get better at Limited or whatever, you can also donate to my Patreon, which you can find a link to in my description below. Thanks for watching.